Well, good morning, Recharge Nation. It is indeed a pleasure of mine to be with you yet another week. My name is Pastor Carleen Hepburn from ReCharge Ministries, where I proudly serve with my husband, Pastor Mark Hepburn. I pray that today that you will be blessed by the outpouring of the word, the Rhema word that the Lord has for us today as we set in on this fireside chat today. Draw up a little close. Let's get a little close today because the Lord indeed has a word for you. And here at ReCharge Ministries, the Logos is in action, the word in action, where we're family-centered, where we have a servant's heart, and where purpose must be fulfilled. So today, the Lord has a word for each and every one of us. Amen. And before I go into the word that the Lord has laid upon my heart to come and pour into you today, let us pray. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, as we gather in your presence, we come before you with hearts filled with reverence and gratitude. We acknowledge your sovereignty and wisdom, knowing that the conclusion of our stories is not determined by our circumstances, but by your divine declaration. In the midst of life uncertainties, we find assurance in the truth that our destinies are held in your hands. Just as Ruth declared that the conclusion isn't determined until God says it's over, we embrace the hope that your timing and purpose prevail in our lives. Lord, grant us the faith to trust in your perfect plan, even when the path seems unclear. I pray we draw strength from the understanding that your declaration supersedes any challenges we face in life. As we embark on this journey, we surround our fears and uncertainties with you, knowing that the confidence that you have placed in us and knowing that the promises that you have that's looming over us, oh God, are true and yea and amen. Guide us, Heavenly Father, and help us recognize that our stories are written by your hands. I pray your divine declaration be our source of hope, peace, and unwavering faith. As we navigate the chapters of our lives, let your will be done. Father, let your will be done. And I pray your glory will be revealed in every page of our lives. So we offer this prayer up in the name of the Father, the Son, and the blessed Holy Ghost. And we say amen and amen. Glory, hallelujah. So the word this morning that the Lord asked me to pour out on you today is, the conclusion isn't determined until God declares it. The conclusion isn't determined until God declares it. And I love subtitles this morning. And the subtitle is, because there is a threshing floor miracle for you and for me. Because before the blessing, there is a threshing. But the major theme this morning is, the conclusion isn't determined until God declares it. I want somebody to put that in the chat room this morning. The conclusion isn't determined until God declares it. Meaning the conclusion is your end. Your end is not determined until God declares it. Hallelujah. So there is somebody this morning that's going through something, and you're saying, God, where are you? The Lord sent me this morning just for you to say, the conclusion isn't determined. Your end is not determined until I, God, declares it in your life. What are you declaring? Whose report do you believe this morning? Because I know that I believe the report of the Lord. Hallelujah. I believe his report. What the doctors say, oh my God, I gotta go to Nice City and say, Lord, what do you say? What does your word say? Hallelujah, because we must align with the word of the Lord. So this morning, I'm here to declare and to decree to you that the conclusion isn't determined until God declares it. Hallelujah. Glory. So this morning's scripture is taken from Ruth 3, 2 through 7. Ruth 3, 2 through 7. And the month of March is really dedicated to women. And yesterday was International Women's Day. And so I just want to say congratulations to all women out there that's doing it, right? And that's why today's message is really here. But it's for all of us, even though I'm leading with Ruth and the book of Ruth today. Amen. And so the word again is taken from Ruth 3, 2 through 7. Then her mother-in-law Naomi said to her, my daughter, shall I not seek security for you, that it may go well for you? Now then, is Boaz not our relative with whose young woman you were? Behold, he is winnowing barley at the threshing floor tonight. Wash yourself, therefore, and anoint yourself and put on your best clothes and go down to the threshing floor. But do not reveal yourself to the man until he has finished eating and drinking. And it shall be when he lies down that you shall take notice of the place where he lies. And you shall go and uncover his feet and lie down. And then he will tell you what you should do. And she said to her, all that you said, I will do. And so she went down to the threshing floor and did according to all that her mother-in-law had commanded her. When Boaz had eaten and drunk and his heart was cheerful, he went to lie down at the end of the heap of grain. And she came secretly and uncovered his feet and lay down. And it happened in the middle of the night that the man was startled and bent forward, and behold, a woman was lying at his feet. So he said, who are you? And she answered, I am Ruth, your slave. Hallelujah. Now spread your garment over your slave, for you are a redeemer. I went to verse 9. So 3 through 9 this morning. So like I said, there's a lot that the Lord want to share with us this morning. And for women specifically, every woman who has had an experience, an encounter with God, carries a unique story. We carry a unique story that's woven into the fabric of our lives. And so, for example, Sarah's testimony echoes, no challenge is too formidable for God. Hagar's narrative resonates. Even in the vast desert, God is ever present. Rahab affirms God can work through anyone. Anna's assurance is, my God responds to earnest prayers. Here, Ruth asserts the conclusion isn't determined until God declares it. Esther's revelation declares God can elevate the unworthy to nobility. Elizabeth's proclamation assures even in advanced age, greatness can be birthed. Mary's testimony echoes, God's promises come to fruition has spoken. The woman with the issue of blood testifies, when all else falters, God remains steadfast. Mary and Martha's shared wisdom, even lifeless things can be reverbed. Oh my God. Even lifeless things can be revived again, reverberated again, restored again. And Dorcas imparts, God never overlooks our acts of kindness towards others. So what are you saying this morning, Pastor Carleen? Because I want to rest on the book of Ruth this morning. And what did I say that Ruth's book is all about? The conclusion isn't determined until God declares it. So the book of Ruth opens with devastation. Nothing goes well for Naomi's family. Nothing at all. The story begins with famine in the land. For Naomi's family, they flee to Moab to escape famine to stay alive. As a result, Naomi lost her husband, then her two sons. She lost her identity because poverty set in. Her reputation was at stake. And Naomi finds herself hopeless as famine and death characterize her existence. In the eyes of others, she had the status of a cursed woman. And Naomi, because of her trials, simply was broken and bitter. Now, how do you respond when circumstances turn ugly around you, either because of your own doing or by the happenstance of life? So Naomi returns to Bethlehem and her two widowed daughter-in-laws came with her. But Naomi responds. There was a response that Naomi gave. She said, go return each of you to your mother's house. May the Lord deal kindly with you as you have dealt with the dead and with me. So Orpha went back home to her family. But her daughter-in-law, Ruth, hung on to her and said, do not entreat me to leave you or to return from following you. For where you lodge, I will lodge. Where your people shall be, my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there will I be buried. May the Lord do so to me, and more also, if anything but death parts me from you. Wow. That's what her daughter-in-law, Ruth, said to her. And this I will characterize as the essence of loyal love on full display. Because what did I say? The other one, when she said, go back home. When Naomi said, go back home. Not to one, but to two. Orpha went back home to be with her family. But Ruth says, do not entreat me to leave you. That's what she said. She hung on to her number one. So I can just imagine how she grabbed on to her and said, do not entreat me to leave you or to return from following you. For where you lodge, I will lodge. Meaning that where you stay, I'm going to be there. Your people shall be my people. Whoever your people are, they will be mine now because I am clinging on to you as your God, my God. So it didn't matter what I believed before because now I'm being adopted. Now I'm being taken on into your family. And no matter what you say, I am staying with you because where you die, I will die. And there will I be buried. Because if you didn't hear me the first time, I am staying. And may the Lord do so to me, and more also of anything but death parts me from you. This was like a marriage covenant. Because the marriage covenant said, till death do us part. And that's what Ruth was basically saying to Naomi. If anything but death parts me from you. And this I characterize as the essence of loyal love on full display. So just when Naomi's declaring that God has no loyal love for her because her husband died, her kids died, her sons died, and she's saying, God, have you forgotten me? Where are you, God? Then out of the clear blue, her daughter-in-law put on full display what it means to have loyalty towards someone, even though her husband died. And therefore, she was not committed any longer to stay with Naomi. So while Naomi was in her stupor saying, God has no loyal love for me because look what happened to me, Ruth exhibits loyal love by this stunning response. Do not entreat me to leave you or to return from following you. The Moabite woman declares she will follow the God of Israel and will remain loyal to this embittered, cursed woman. Because that's what Naomi said. I am cursed because my husband died. My two sons died. My reputation is no more. Everyone is saying I'm cursed. But Ruth looks at the circumstances and choice and choose to align herself with the God of Naomi, whom Naomi declares as he turned his back on her. But Ruth stayed. She stayed. And Naomi's silent now, as she's so focused on her circumstances swirling all around her that she can't see anything out because she has no hope. And the rest of the story begins answering the question Naomi asked, is there hope? Because my husband died. My two sons died. I have no money. I have nothing. Is there hope? And does God have loyal love towards his children, even when they turn their backs on him? Because Naomi turned her back on God because she lost hope. So the question this morning, does God have loyal love towards his people, his children, even when they turn their backs on him? But Ruth the Moabite again does the unexpected thing. Because she could have gone home to her country. Instead, she goes out into the field to now work for her mother-in-law. She became the breadwinner. She took on the responsibility. Because what did I say? The husband died. The two sons died. Naomi became hopeless. I would probably dare to say that Naomi went into a corner and she just sat there. Just waiting to die. Because she gave up hope. She gave up on life. But her daughter-in-law is saying, oh no, you don't. Because I'm going to step in. Though life wasn't fair to you, I'm going to step in and I'm going to restore you back again. Because I'm not going home to be with my country, to be with my family. I'm going to stay right here. And so instead, she goes out into the field to now work and to provide for the adopted family that she took on. And the town took notice. I want you to know, Everybody took notice. They marveled. Who is this woman? She went to the field of a man named Boaz and marvels at how, you know, and he marvels at how Ruth, the foreigner, respond to the situation. Because she got the right to leave, but she stayed. And he explains, the Lord repay you for what you have done. And a full reward be given you by the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to take refuge. That's what chapter 2 says. And Boaz recognizes that Ruth has placed herself under the care of the God of Israel. She placed herself there because what did she say? Your God will be my God. Naomi, even though you're not believing him right now, even though you're not trusting him right now, whoever your God is, it's my God, and I'm going to believe for the both of us. You lost hope. You're in the corner. You gave up on life. But I'm going to believe in your God. I'm going to believe for us, even though you might not see it just yet. Then Boaz responds even more unexpectedly when speaking to his workers. He says, let her gleam even among the sheaves and do not reproach her. And also pull out some from the bundles for her and leave it for her to gleam and do not rebuke her. There was favor on Ruth. And understand that this is not normal. I want you to know that this is not normal. This is not an excessive amount of food for her to be able to gather. But verse 17 in the second chapter says that she got about an ephah. And I don't know what an ephah is. We don't really know exactly how much that is in this period, except for it's far more than Naomi and Ruth needed at the time. And when Ruth goes home to Naomi, suddenly Naomi's disposition, it changed. And she responds in chapter 2, verse 20, that perhaps God has not abandoned his loyal love. She responds with kindness. The woman that was hopeless saw a glimmer. She now sees a glimmer of hope because she realizes now that she's not alone. The daughter-in-law that she told to leave stayed and is now working to keep the both of them alive. She's working to provide for the both of them. She's saying, I'm going to believe for the both of us. God. I want to pause right here because some of you might not be believing. Some of you might have lost hope. But God is going to send someone that's going to believe not only for themselves, but believe for you. Because you don't see it just yet. You can't see the forest from the trees. Because everything is dark around you. Everything seems desolate. But God is going to send someone that's going to say that no matter how you're feeling, I'm going to believe for the both of us. Hallelujah. I'm going to believe for the both of us. You might not see it yet, but I'm going to believe that we're going to get out of this. I'm going to believe that you're going to get out of this. I'm going to pour back life into you. That's what Ruth did. Ruth poured back life into a dead situation. It was dead physically because of the death that was around them. It was dead emotionally because when death comes in, my God, It does something to you. It sucks the very life out of you. And that's how Naomi was feeling in that moment. She experienced death physically to the loss of her husband and her two sons. That spiritually she was dead. But there was Ruth that says, I'm going to believe for the both of us. I'm going to believe in your God. I'm going to stay with you. I'm going to dry your tears. I'm going to pull you out whether you want to come out or not. Because I'm going to stay right here. Glory. So in that moment, after Naomi saw what Ruth is doing, and she realized that God has not abandoned her because he's showing kindness to her, the glimmer of hope was restored. Naomi began to think differently. She began to see her situation through the lens of her faith, because faith started to restore. She started to trust God again. That God is going to restore her family's good name. She knew that if things were ever going to turn around for her and Ruth, my God, she was going to have to put on her ingenuity hat. She was going to have to see life in a different way, because Boaz and Ruth had to come together in order to take them out of where they were. If her lost land was going to be restored, Boaz was going to have to open his heart to Ruth. And Ruth was the key to opening Boaz's heart. Don't you see how God works? When the tide begins to turn, when the tide begins to change, you start to see the Lord in a different way. So Ruth 3 and verse 2 says, Now is not Boaz our kinsman, with whose maids you were? Behold, he's winnowing the barley at the threshing floor tonight. In essence, what Naomi was trying to teach Ruth is that time was of the essence. And because the critical time of the harvest was upon them, once the harvest was gathered, the practice of the threshing began with intentionality. My God. It involved crushing the crops under the weight of a sledge or grinding wheels attached to the heavy hoofers of the oxen. The mixture was tossed into the air, allowing the wind to separate the straw from the seed, which is called the winnowing. It is when the chaff and the wheat are separated, allowing the seed to fall and collect on the ground. The winnowing was done at night when the wind picked up, and the harvest sheaves were thrown into the wind, and the chaff was blown away as the wheat fell to the threshing floor. So for us, the threshing floor, what happens on the threshing floor? It is where the good is sifted from the bad. It's where the strong and the resilient nature can be separated from the weak-minded. It is where the positive is separated from the negative. That's the threshing floor. I hope somebody's hearing me this morning. The threshing floor is where the good is shifted, it's sifted from the bad. It's where the strong and the resilient nature can be separated from the weak-mindedness. It's where the positive is separated from the negative. That's a threshing floor. Because each of us has negative things and traits in our lives and personalities that needs to be shifted out. It needs to be sifted out of us. Things that need not to be there. And it needs to be removed and sifted out of us. And in Naomi's case, her problems made her bitter. And that bitterness had to be sifted from her life. And each of us must be sifted so that the chaff of our lives are removed. How many of us, because of hurt, we became bitter and cold and callous? Our hearts are hardened. How many? It even changed our personality. I'm going to just interject something here because it's not in my notes. As I'm reading this, it's really true. Because something happened to me about a week and a half ago where somebody literally said something so unfeeling, uncaring to me, even after I was in the trenches with that person. And in that moment, because it not happened once, but it happened twice. The first time I thought the person was emotionally charged. They were tired. They were at their wit's end and they had no idea what they were saying. So it was mere words coming off the lips. So even though it hurt the first time, the words that were used, I gave the person a pass. Because there was a project that needed to be completed and I couldn't focus on what just happened, the negative that just happened, the attack that just happened. I couldn't focus on that because there was a project that had a deadline and I needed to focus on that. But when the project was over and the person was told to apologize, you know, the person said to me, now everybody's now good. We're relaxed. We've had sleep. We're relaxing. The person came back and the person said, I meant every word I said. What I said, I meant every word I said. But if you want an apology, I'm sorry, but I meant every word I said. Whew. Now, here we were, 4 days later, fresh pair of eyes, in our right mind, no stress, nothing to cloud the judgment, and the person said, I meant every word I said. In that moment, my heart ripped in a million pieces because I was in the trenches. I was on the battlefield. And to be so unkind, and the words that came from that individual that I thought was in exhaustion, was in stress, was truly the heart of the person. In that moment, I chose silence because it just so happens that morning manna that week we were talking about silence is golden. And I left the room without saying a word. But the only choice words that I used was, that's not me. And if that's who you think I am, you have no clue about who I am. And in that moment where I said that, negative things can change your personality. In that moment, I felt like my personality could have changed. Would I ever help somebody else? Because after I was out there in the trenches and no one appreciated it, would I ever extend my kindness again? In that moment, the enemy stepped in and the enemy said, don't give your kindness away again. Don't be kind again, because look what happened. And you know how great a mighty God is, that he sent someone to speak into me that day, because my heart was about to get hardened. My doors were about to shut. But someone came and said, that's not who you are. Your DNA doesn't replicate that. Continue being who you are. So that threshing floor is real. And it's at that threshing floor where God can truly begin to bless us like never before. Because he's separating the positive from the negative. He's separating the anger from the joy. My God, he's separating the good from the bad. He's taking out all that don't belong. Even when life has not been fair, he will remove it. Because prior to your major breakthrough, there will be major breaking down. And I had to see that when I came under attack. I said, God, there is a breakthrough coming. But what did I just say? Prior to a major breakthrough, there will be major breaking down in your life to shift you away from where you need to focus. But sometimes the breakdown is God sifting stuff out of you. He's sifting the bad so that the good can come forward. He's sifting out the negative so that the positive can come forward. He's sifting out the weakness out of you so strength and resilience can be restored. He's sifting out the pridefulness, the boastfulness, so that humility can be erected in your life. That's God. Because the threshing floor is real. And Luke 22:1 verse 31 states, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has demanded permission to sift you like wheat. That is Satan asking Jesus if he could sift Peter's faith. I want you to know that all spiritual testing is about your faith. And the testing is to make your faith stronger. So while I was hurt, I had to keep my eyes on God. I said, God, I see the devil in operation. And I'm not fighting against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers in diverse places. Yes, she was present, but there's a spirit behind her, and I must deal with that spirit. Because Satan's aim is to send tests to destroy, to cripple your faith, and derail your confidence in God. In Job 2 and verse 9, Satan took everything from Job in an attempt to get him to curse God. But he continued to trust God. Ah, my God, what did I say? I continued to trust God. The devil wanted to change my DNA. The devil wanted my heart to harden against people. But God came and said, oh no, that's not who you are. That's not who I created. Oh my God. Because when it comes time for the threshing floor, Satan intends to rob you of your blessing, wreck your confidence in God's provision, and doubt your adoption and heritage that you are a true son and daughter of the Most High God. My God, that's what Satan wanted to do last week. He wanted to rob me of my joy. He wanted to rob me of my peace. Oh, God. He wanted to rob me. He wanted to rob me of my blessing. He wanted to wreck my very confidence in God's provision. He wanted me to doubt that I am his child and I have an inheritance. He wanted to rob me that I'm a true daughter of the Most High God. But I want you to know this morning that God will allow the testing to remove the chaff so that you can build better character in him. I want you to know that Peter's testing came before he was used to head up the church in Jerusalem. Job's testing came before his devil portioned a blessing. My God, the testing came before the double portion. The double portion couldn't come until the testing came. Job 42 and verse 10 says, the Lord restored the fortunes of Job when he prayed for his friends, and the Lord increased all that Job had twofold. So as with Ruth, she had to be steadfast and faithful. Then the Lord brought her to the floor of Boaz. Ruth 3 and verse 3 says, watch thyself therefore, and anoint thee, and put thy raiment upon thee, and get thee down to the floor, but make not thyself known unto the man until he shall have done eating and drinking. So she had to be steadfast and faithful. And then the Lord brought her to the floor of Boaz. DJ Press, please play. He's in the room. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Don't let our praise be empty space. Come by in this place. Every heart you are transforming. Come and move. Have your glory. Darkness trembles, mountains crumble when you draw near. Strongholds breaking, destinies changing. When you draw near to us, you draw near to us.
He's in the room. Jesus is in the room. And when he's in the room, get God's attention when he's in the room. When God is in the room, you gotta get his attention. So Naomi understood something about men when she told Ruth to wait for Boaz to eat before she approached him. Because you gotta get God's attention when he's in the room. And what Naomi said was, she said, let his attention be fully on you, undistracted. Wait for the night time, and he'll give you anything you want. She said, get dolled up. Hear well done. Eyes twinkle, smoky eyes, if you will, which is a far cry from her everyday field clothes. Woman, you know how we do. And that's how Naomi was telling Ruth she had to be. She said, do all these things. Notice that Naomi didn't tell Ruth to go in there as she was, which was unattractive, filthy clothes, and asking Boaz for stuff. So the representation had to be right. I want you to know that Ruth got Boaz's attention before she moved into greater favor. In regards to us and God, how do we get God's attention? Some of us go to the Lord and immediately say, help. I want, give me, give us. That's how we approach God. But there's a method and a way this morning. We must understand and know and pay close attention that Jesus, Yeshua HaMashiach, did not start his prayers asking the Father for stuff. He said, listen closely. In Matthew 6, verse 9, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. My God, what did he do? He bragged on the Father. So bragging was what he did. It's important that you understand that worship is the gateway to the heart of God. He moves towards us when we minister to him through worship. Worship gets God's attention. My God. Worship gets God's attention. The topic was get God's attention. That was key points. Get God's attention. But worship gets God's attention. And when Ruth got Boaz's attention, it was time to get down to business. The time of divine reversal. It was the moment Naomi and Ruth needed to change their destiny. And Boaz was the man to do it. My God. Ruth had known Boaz as a stranger, then a boss, as a friend. And now it's leaving the friend zone. Naomi told Ruth exactly what to wear, to say, when to say it. Listen to what Naomi said and instructed Ruth to do. My God. She said to her, now is not Boaz our kinsman, with whose maid you were? Behold, he is winnowing barley at the threshing floor tonight. Wash yourself, therefore, and anoint yourself, and put on your best clothes and go down to the threshing floor. But do not make yourself known to the man until he has finished eating and drinking. It shall be when he lies down and that you shall notice the place where he lies, and you shall go and uncover his feet and lie down, and then he will tell you what you shall do. So Ruth was specifically told to pay attention when Boaz sleeps and lays down. When you go to God, do you know what to do to get his attention? Because there's a process. There's a process of worship. There's a process of bragging on him. There's a process of building him up and saying, how great,
art. Father, how great is thy name in all the earth. Father, how excellent are you. Father, you are the everlasting portion. You are the Shaddai, the God of plenty. You are the Almighty God. You see how I'm loving on God. I'm loving on him because he is the great I am. I didn't just run in and start with my laundry list of things. Ruth didn't go in with her dirty self. My God, the same way she rolled out of, you know, the field, she wasn't going to go in that same way. She adorned herself. My God, she prepared herself before she went in, my God. And she followed instructions. And in context of this story, the enemies would watch and wait from afar. As the farmers planted, they watered the soil and pulled the weeds and harvest wheat and winnowing the wheat. And after the work had been done, the enemy would attack the threshing floor and rob the farmer of his harvest and increase. That's the devil. The devil waits for the appointed time. And the devil doesn't play fear. What did I say? I was in the trenches with the person that verbally attacked me. I was in the trenches. So the devil doesn't play fear. But what does John 10 verse 10 says? The thief comes only to steal, to kill and destroy. But here is what God says. I came that you would have life and have it more abundantly. So when the enemy comes in to kill, steal, and to destroy, God say, oh no, because I come so that you might have life and you can have it more abundantly. The enemy will not let you pray and plant your seed and get to the brink of the harvest and then bring a problem that will eat. He will bring a problem to eat your finances and to steal the blessing that you've been waiting for. That's the enemy. But the threshing floor is a place where the good and the bad meets. The perfect and the imperfect are separated. And a place of battle. Oh, I slept next to the grain in case the enemy tried to come in that night to steal it. And Ruth, by lying at Boaz's feet, it showed him something. And if you're reading the scripture, I want you to go back and you will see this. So Boaz slept next to the grain in case the enemy tried to come in that night, because that's how the enemy operate, to steal. But Ruth, by lying at Boaz's feet, was showing him something. She showed that I'll stay with you no matter what comes through that gate. Whoa. She was showing Boaz that I'll stay with you no matter what comes through that gate. Many of us, we oftentimes think the threshing floor is where we get hurt, where experience is lost, where we're beaten. But God showed me something about the threshing floor. God is showing us today that he's strengthening us. He's preparing us. He's renewing us on the threshing floor. Because sometimes we think the threshing floor is a bad place to be. Because the threshing floor is where we often think of hurt and loss and we're beaten. But God is saying today that he is strengthening us. He's preparing us. He's renewing us on the threshing floor. Because on the threshing floor, battles turn into blessings. When we fall on the floor in deep, intimate prayer and worship before God. And that's why the Lord says, the threshing floor, miracles happen. on the threshing floor. Because the threshing floor is a place of separation and revelation. And because it was a place where the harvest was prepared for separating the grain from the useless trough for the purpose of exposing and collecting the most valuable parts of the crop, the threshing floor process is a beautiful picture of worship. And it's a metaphor for sanctification. The threshing floor, a place of worship, is where God's provision for us is on earth. Our responsibility is to cooperate with the process. I said that in my 6 o'clock preaching this morning on another platform. Our responsibility is to cooperate with the process. Not to dismiss the process, not to get out of the process, but our responsibility is to cooperate with the process and in turn honor God with the bounty of what is revealed. And this progression of refinement is much like our lives. On a personal level, we plant seeds and tend to our crops in hopes of a bountiful harvest. We do this in all of our relationships, our careers, our personal aspirations. However, our best efforts often get choked out by the weeds of pride, tears of selfishness, and the chaffs of the lost hope. So what issues is in your life that we're saying, God, place it on the threshing floor? What is keeping you up at night? What are the thorns in your flesh that you would like to bury 6 feet under? Perhaps you've been running from God and yet he continues to pull you back onto the threshing floor because he's inviting you into his divine plan of healing and restoration. And he does this not to harass you or cause you any undue pain. But it's in his tender mercy. He wants to open up your eyes to what is hidden inside that pain, that conflict, and that conviction. There are lessons to discover to serve and honor God from a place of authenticity. Will it be painful to surrender to his process of refinement? Absolutely. It's a guarantee. However, we must submit and offer up our pride, our fears, our doubts, our unbeliefs, our resentments to the winnowing breath of the Holy Spirit. It's in this place of wholehearted surrender that God can and God will move powerfully to heal our hearts and take you to new depth in his relationship that he wants to form with you. So in closing, Naomi, this woman who had her whole life unraveled at the beginning of the story, who doubted that God was showing her loyal love, who lost all hope, this woman discovered that through the very broken trials, God had in fact been showing loyal love, unconditional love, agape love. He had not abandoned her. In fact, he had not only worked in her life, but through her circumstances, he had brought about the Davidic line, the very line that the Messiah Jesus Christ himself came from. Did she always see and feel his loyal love? The answer is no. At times it was horribly dark. But did God's loyal love turn away from her? No. Even when her family turned their backs on the God of Israel and fled to Moab, he did not stop showing loyal love. Where is your hope level right now? Are you like Naomi? Feeling no hope? Many of you are enduring what seems like yet again another difficult, heavy year. You have lost family and friends to death. You have seen losses in your lives. You have seen stresses pile up in different closets of your life, many of which you don't want to open up because you're fearful about what others might see. Hope instead of virtue. Hope is a virtue that is rooted in and flourishes in nothing else but the characteristics of God, especially his character of loyal love. And in the book of Ruth, you see the character of God on displays as he shows Naomi step by step that he's indeed overflowing with loyal love. God's character is a soil that the virtue of hope grows in. Here is what hope really is. Hope is a practice of believing God's loyal love as true for my situation right now and the future. Our God, his tender mercies are ever true. I find myself once again meeting you on the threshing floor. And through this process of refinement, revealing me, God, that honors you. How are you going to honor God? How are you going to honor him as you meet him on the threshing floor of miracle? The threshing floor is where you will meet him. The threshing floor is where your breakthrough is going to come through. The threshing floor is where he will sift the bad things out of your life so that the good things will remain and it will grow. That's God this morning. That's him this morning. Because a conclusion isn't determined until God declares it. The conclusion isn't determined. The conclusion, the end, is not defined until God declares it. Now, will you declare it today, what God says concerning your life? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we conclude our time together in your presence, our heart is lifted in gratitude for the reassurance that the conclusion of our stories rests in your hands. Your wisdom surpasses our understanding. We find comfort in the knowledge that the final chapters of our lives are not determined by circumstance, but by your divine declaration. Lord, we surrender our anxieties, our uncertainties, and aspirations to you, trusting in your perfect plan. Just as Ruth proclaimed that the conclusion isn't determined until God says it's over, we hold fast to the hope that your timing is impeccable and your purpose prevail. As we step into the unknown future, I pray your guiding light illuminate our path. Grant us discernment to recognize your voice and amidst life's noises, and courage to follow where you lead. I pray your declarations of love, grace, and purpose echo in our hearts, shaping our journeys with unwavering faith, O God. Yes, Lord, we trust you like never before, Almighty God. We trust you, God, that you know how, God, our end, oh God, even before it is our end, Lord God Almighty. We trust you in this time, Lord God. And as we step into the unknown future, I pray your guiding light illuminate our path, oh God, today. I pray that it illuminates our path today, oh God. I thank you. Lord, bless and keep us. And I pray your peace abide with us. And your unfailing love be the anchor of our souls as we entrust our stories to your care. And we anticipate the unfolding of your divine will with hope and anticipation. Oh God, we thank you today for your word and your download, oh God. And we thank you for your pouring out, oh God. And I pray that it will take root and it will grow and it will germinate, Father, for your glory and your fulfillment upon our lives.
I seal this prayer now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the blessed Holy Ghost. And I say amen and amen and amen. This is Pastor Carleen Hepburn from ReCharge Ministries. And I pray that that word really seep into your heart and into your spirit today. The conclusion isn't determined until God declares it. And I pray that you will see God and you will experience him on the threshing floor of your life. Because miracles, signs, and wonders does happen on the threshing floor. May God bless and keep you. And we will see and hear each other again next week, Thursday. Next week, God bless you.
Come on, you ought to just slip a hand in the air right there. Oh, Jesus, there's no telling what can happen. And Jesus is in the room. There's no telling what can happen. And Jesus is in the room.